Hello everyone, welcome to session 13 of Genomic Variant Analysis and Clinical Interpretation Workshop. Today, we are going to talk on clarification and discussion on practice dataset 2. Before we start the session, let me go through the key points that I'm going to discuss in today's session. So today I'm going to discuss three major attributes which were a major concern for most of you. So PP4, PP5 and PS4 with an example. After that, I will discuss on which papers to read and which to ignore, because this also has been one of the major doubts of all of you. Along with that, I'm going to talk on what do you do when you find conflicting evidence, and what do you do when you do not find any literature supporting a variant? When do you stop mining for more literature? So these were some of the major doubts that I was constantly receiving from many of you. So let me go through each of the points one by one. So let us first start with the first attribute, that is PP4. So for PP4, as we discussed in the previous few lectures, there are four criteria that should be satisfied. If all the four criteria are fulfilled, then we can assign the attribute of PP4 to any variant. So let us look at what are the four criteria. So the first criteria is that the clinical sensitivity should be high. The second criteria is that it should be a single gene disorder. The third criteria is that the less than 50% of the variations in that gene in which the variant lies should be benign. And the last criteria is that the family history with the mode of inheritance should be consistent. So let us look at each of the criteria in detail and let us learn how to assign it. So let us learn all of this with an example. So for today's session, I have picked up six variants. For today's demo, I'm going to use three variants from practice set 1 and three variants from practice set 2. And I'm going to annotate all these variants together in using VP. So firstly, I'm going to make, so these are the six variants. Three are an HG38 version and three are an HG19 version. I'm going to make a VCF file for all these variants. So in the VCF format, we have put dots wherever the information is not available. So I'm going to use the chromosomal position for annotating with VP. So VP as well, we need two versions, one for the HG37 version and one for the HG38 version. So I have pasted the data accordingly. So now let us select all the columns according to what we need. So I'm going to check the RefSeq radio button. Along with that, I'm going to tick all these boxes. And I will then need the allele frequency information, which I'm not going to use in this session, but I will be needing in the future sessions. So that is why I'm just taking all of them. So now we can run the HG37 version. And then let us do the same for the HG38 version as well. So I will need the RefSeq transcripts. I will need all the information for protein and HGBS. I will need all the allele frequency information from different data sets. I will need the exon intron numbers. I will need the predictions for CAD. And then I can run this run as well. So we will wait till the analysis gets completed.
So the analysis is now completed for HG19 version. So let us view the results. So as you can see, these are the different transcripts for this particular gene. So three variants has multiple transcripts. So and this one variant has only single transcript. So we will use this information and do the further analysis. The analysis has also been completed for the HG38 version. And as you can see, there are NMIDs as well as XMIDs. So this has been also one of the major doubts. So first we'll try to understand what are the NMIDs and what are the XMIDs. So this information is clarified in the RefSeq database. So as you can see and read, that accession numbers which begin from XM, XR and XP are produced from genome annotation pipeline or copied computationally, which means they are not curated IDs. So that is why we will use IDs which have curated information, that is
NM, NR, and NP. So from henceforth, we will not refer to the XM, XR, and XP IDs. We will only refer to the NM, NR, and the NP IDs. So let us go back to VP and copy all the information that we need about the variants. So I have noted down all the information that I need for the HE19 version and for the HE38 version as well. So let us start with the annotations. So to understand PP4 with great detail, let us look at a variant from practice dataset 2 in the ATP7B gene, which I have annotated with the help of VEP and retrieved the cDNA position and the protein change and the DBSNP or the RSID. So let us look at how to annotate this particular variant. How to assess if the clinical sensitivity is high. So first, what we need to do is we need to check if all the patients have a similar phenotype, and this itself is not counted as evidence for pathogenicity, as most patients who come to the clinic and have a similar phenotype will only be sent for variant analysis, and hence this itself is not counted as evidence. Along with this, many patients should have the variant and also exhibit the same phenotype. And we are particularly interested if there are multiple affected members in different families or large families who have the similar phenotype. So this is of particular interest to us. So the second criteria is that how do we assess if it is a single gene disorder? So the criteria that is laid down by ACMG mentions that there should be many affected individuals, and these individuals should have a unique phenotype that is characteristic to that particular disorder. One way of ensuring this is that the disease should be a single gene disorder having a characteristic phenotype which is particular to that disease and that gene. How to assess if less than 50% of the variants are benign, which is the next criteria. So this we can do with the help of ClinVar database. So what we will now do is that we will search for this particular gene in the ClinVar database. So we were looking at a variant at ATP7B gene. And here after searching, we can get the number of variants following in different categories of clinical significance. So if we note the numbers, then we will see that the benign and likely benign mutations for ATP7B gene are in total of 204 out of a total of 1079 variants, which fall into different categories of pathogenic, likely pathogenic, conflicting, benign, and likely benign. And that is why the percentage of benign mutations is 18%. Which is less than 50%. So if we encounter encounter any variant in ATP7B gene which follows through the other three categories, then we can assign the criteria of PP4, because the percentage of benign variants is less than 50% in this particular gene. So how to assess if the family history and the mode of inheritance is consistent? So the first and the last criteria can be assessed simultaneously, along with identifying the literature for multiple individuals affected with the same phenotype and are harboring the variant. One needs to make sure that the familial segregation is observed in these families harboring the variant. So now what we need to do is that we'll check the literature and try to understand if all the four criteria are met for this particular variant. And how do we do that? We will now use the information retrieved from VEP for that particular variant. So for the ATP7B variant, there are 5 transcripts, and for each of these transcripts, we are going to perform the literature search. So let us start with the first transcript, cDNA change of the first transcript. So as you can see in Google Scholar, there are no articles retrieved. In PubMed, there are no articles retrieved. And in PMC as well, this search term was not found. So let us now search through the protein change. So in Google Scholar, no item. So there was one article retrieved. So let us search through this article.
So this particular term was found in the reference, so we should ignore this article. In PMC, there were no results retrieved, and in PubMed as well, in PubMed and PMC, there were no results retrieved. So now let us look at the second cDNA change. So for the second cDNA change, no articles were retrieved in Google Scholar, and no articles were retrieved in PubMed as well. No articles were retrieved in PMC as well. So now let us look at the protein change of the second transcript. So no articles retrieved, no articles retrieved, and no articles retrieved. So now let us move on to the third cDNA change. So no articles retrieved. No articles retrieved, no articles retrieved. So let us look at the protein change. No articles retrieved, no articles retrieved, and no articles retrieved. So let us try for the next cDNA change. No articles retrieved, no articles retrieved, no articles retrieved. So let us try for the next protein change. No articles retrieved, no articles retrieved, no articles retrieved. So let us try for the last cDNA change. So there is one article retrieved and there are six articles retrieved here. So let us look at the one article retrieved from PMC. So this article says that this was found in this family in a compound heterozygous fashion, but then there is no details about cis or trans. So this particular variant is found in family T, family 35 and family 47 in a homozygous condition, and family 55 in compound heterozygous condition along with another variant. So now, since they have mentioned that it is present in three families in a homozygous condition, we should now look at if there are any details about these three families so that we can assign the attribute of PP1. On this particular paper, there is no detail. So let us look at the supplementary of this particular article. So in the supplementary, let us search for this particular variant. So it is present in family T, family 35, two members of family 35 and one member in family 47. So in the starting, some pedigrees were shown. Let us look at the pedigrees. So here is family T, and we know that one member was affected, family 35, and two members were affected. Probably they might have not taken the sample from this member who is no more, and family 47, two members were affected. So family 55, where it is present in a compound heterozygous fashion. So these are the details about the variant. So here is a table of clinical features of all the Wilson disease patients. So here they measure the age of onset, serum copper levels, ceruloplasmin levels, urinary protein levels, the KF ring and the jaundice history and hepatomegaly. So let us look at what is the status of the families that we are interested in. So as you can see, for family 5, T255, all patients have a similar phenotype and all have the KF ring. So with this we can ensure that the phenotype of the all these patients were the same and all these patients had the particular variant. Hence, with the help of this particular article and these details about the patients, we can assign the PP1 attribute and one of the PP4 criteria to this particular variant. So this is the sentence that I retrieved from. We can assign the PP1 as well as PP4 category. As we already saw that the variant had less than 50% of the mutations which were benign, and it is also a single gene disorder. So how to verify that it is a single gene disorder? We will simply search on Google about this particular gene. Then we will look at the Medline and the gene cards result. So the health condition related to this particular gene is only Wilson disease. And even on gene cards, let us see what are the diseases associated. So here in starting is, itself, there is only Wilson disease that is mentioned and there is no other particular disorder that is mentioned. And hence, we know that this is a single gene disorder. So with the help of that one article, I made sure that the clinical sensitivity is high and the family history is consistent with the mode of inheritance. We made sure that it is a single gene disorder by searching through Google, and we made sure that less than 50% of the mutations were benign by searching through ClinVar, and hence we can assign the PP4 attribute to that particular variant. So in this variant as well, we saw that there were multiple transcripts and we searched with each of the transcript NMIDs and the protein chain. But here make note that I have not completely annotated the variant. I just read through one article, but there are many other articles retrieved via the Google search result. So I have not completely annotated this particular article, but I only demonstrated on how to assign the attribute of PP4 to that particular variant. So let us look at another attribute which raised many questions for most of you. So for assigning the BP5 attribute, the following criteria should be fulfilled. The first criteria is that there should be more than one variant present and the other variant should be at an alternate locus. The second criteria is that the other variant should be having a more pathogenic effect as compared to the variant of our interest. And with the help of these two criteria, we should be able to conclude that there is a clear case of alternate cause of disease. So let us look, let us understand this better with the help of an example. So for this, I have picked up one variant in the DSG2 gene, which was having the following cDNA position and change as annotated by VEP. This is the protein change annotated by VEP, and this is the DBSNP or the RSID associated with that particular variant. And for the annotation, I am referring to the following PubMed ID. So let us look at the literature. So we found three hits for that particular protein change in this particular article. So here it says that the mutation screening of the proband showed that this particular mutation was present. And this particular mutation was also tested for in 500 unrelated normal chromosomes, and it was not present. So another mutation in the gene PKP2 is also present. And an analysis of this mutation was done, and it was found out that the mutation that we are interested in is present, was inherited from the paternal side, whereas the mutation in the PKP2 gene was inherited from the maternal side. So that is the second hit. And for the third hit, they are saying that the mutation in family 100 in the DGS2 gene and the PKP2 gene are clearly inherited in dominant fashion. So to understand what is the inheritance of the two genes, we will look at OMIM. And first we will search for the DSG2 gene. We'll open the first hit. So it says that it is an autosomal dominant inheritance. And let us look for the other gene. So for this gene as well, the inheritance is autosomal dominant. So let us come back to the paper. Apart from this, there are no hits, but I found a very interesting result written in the discussion of the article. So here they are saying that in family 100, there were 7 adults carrying the DGS2 mutation. 3 showed a mild form of the disease. So let us look at these 3 subjects, that is 3-9, 4-2, and 4-15. So 3-9. So 3-9 is positive for the DGS2 mutation that we are interested in and is negative for the PKP2 mutation. 4-2 and 4-15. So 4-2 is also positive for the DGS2 mutation, which we are interested in, and is negative for the PKP2 mutation. And 4-15 is also positive for the mutation that we are interested in and is negative for the PKP2 mutation. So all 3 individuals have a mild form of the disease, and three individuals, that is 5-1, 5-2, 5-4, and 5-5 were unaffected. So 5-1, 5-2, all are positive for the DGS2 mutation that we are interested in, but they are unaffected. So the mutation is present in all of these individuals, but few show a mild form of the disease and few are unaffected. In the same family, for 6 mutations carrying the PKP2 mutation, 2 were severely affected, but other 4 did not fulfill the diagnostic criteria for the disease, although they were symptomatic. Then there were other affected subjects who carried the PKP2 mutation and showed the more severe phenotype. In the same family, the presence of double mutations, that is when both the mutations, that is one in DGS2 and in PKP2, the presence of double mutations seem to not have a very severe phenotype, and they have a moderate phenotype. So let us look at these individuals in the pedigree. So 4-13 and 4-16. So 4-13, who are positive for both these mutations, and 4-16, who are also positive for both this mutation. So from here we can understand that there are 2 mutations, and one of the mutation is causing a mild form of the disease, or many people are still unaffected, and the other mutation, when present, is causing a severely affected phenotype. And when both the mutations are present together, the individuals are showing a moderate form of the disease. So with the help of that article, we can conclude that the DGS2 mutation had another mutation at an alternate locus. The other mutation also showed a more pathogenic effect, as those individuals had a more severe form of the disease. And obviously there is a clear case of alternate cause of the disease established through that paper. And hence, we can assign the BP5 attribute to that particular variant on the basis of that particular literature. So I hope by now you are clear how to assign the BP5 attribute. So let us now look at the third variant for which there were many questions, and that is PS4. So PS4 is an attribute that can be assigned with the help of case control studies or association studies, where we are looking for association between the disease and the gene. And we are looking at if the odds ratio is greater than 5 and the confidence interval is greater than 1. So if the odds ratio is greater than 5, then we can assign this particular attribute to that particular variant. And sometimes, as many of you pointed out, that odds ratio is not given in the paper. So in such cases, what you can do is you can use the number of cases and controls for a particular allele 1 and divided by the allele 2. And then calculate the odds ratio. So this is how you can calculate the odds ratio if the odds ratio is not given and the number of cases and controls is given. But if there is no such detail given, then you could choose to ignore such particular articles. But make sure that the odds ratio is greater than 5 when you are assigning the criteria of PBS4 to any particular variant. So for example, I have retrieved this particular article from assignment 1, and I found two publications where the odds ratio was calculated. For the heterozygotes, it was 3. So if this was the only odds ratio, then I would have not assigned PS4. But the odds ratio for the homozygotes is 51, which is much higher than 5. So I assigned the attribute of PS4 to this particular variant. Also, there is another PMID which has a very high odds ratio given for that particular variant. And hence, I chose to give the attribute of PS4 to that particular variant. I hope PS4, BP5 and PP4 is now clear to you. Now let us move to another very common doubt, and that is, what do we do in case there is a conflicting evidence retrieved for any particular variant? So for this, I have retrieved one variant from the second assignment, which was in, and this particular variant is in the RYR1 gene. So this is a retrieved cDNA change that was annotated by VEP, and this is the protein change retrieved from VEP. And this is the DBSNP ID or the RSID. Now let us try to annotate this particular variant. So to annotate this particular variant, let us look at the VEP results. The VEP results show that there are two transcripts for this particular variant, but both the transcripts have the same change and position. So that is why I will only search through one of the changes. So let me search first through the cDNA change of this particular variant. In the transcript, so Google Scholar retrieves around 16 results. So let us look at the first few articles. So in the first article, it is said about this particular variant, but this is only the abstract and the full text is not available. So we will have to somehow get to the full text. Even in the second article, the full text is not available. So we'll have to somehow get to it. The third article is also not available in full text format, so we'll have to somehow get to it. But I have downloaded versions of these articles, so let us browse through it. So this is the first article. So here they say, in the abstract itself, they had said that this particular variant is present in the cis format, and hence we can assign the attribute of BP2 to this particular variant on the basis of this one sentence where they say that it is present in the cis format in 4 unrelated families. Let us look at if there are any other details about that variant. So here details about the entire family is given, where the entire family is either a heterozygote carrier or a compound heterozygote for that particular variant. So it is present in cis. So in this particular article, we could assign the BP2 attribute using that particular article. Let us look at the second article. So this particular variant is present in 5 families. But no other detail is present, so I will choose to ignore this particular article. Let us look at the last article. So they were observed in 3 families, 3 and 7 families. So these 2 variants were inherited in cis format. So in this, so using this publication as well, we can assign the attribute of BP2 to that particular variant. So in this family, it is present in trans. So using this sentence, we can assign the attribute of PM3 to this particular variant. So as you can see, using one publication itself, there are 2 attributes that we assigned, which are contrasting in nature, that is PM3 and BP2, to that same variant. And I assigned both the attributes to that particular variant. So this variant will be PM3 as well as BP2, which are contrasting attributes. So even if we obtain contrasting details, we will have to assign the attribute as it is, without giving a thought on what will be the final result for that particular variant. Just assign the attributes, do not think about what will be the final annotation. So in this way, we can assign conflicting evidences to the same variant on the basis of same or different paper. So in case of conflicting evidences, assign attributes as per evidences provided in the literature. Do not choose to ignore any article. Assign the attributes even if conflicting evidences are observed as compared to other articles, or if conflicting evidences are observed in the same article, just as we saw in one of the articles, for example. So moving forward, let us look at how to annotate the articles using disease-specific annotations. So for example, I retrieved one of the variants in the TGFBR2 gene. This particular variant was present in assignment 2. I annotated this particular variant using VEP and retrieved the cDNA position, the protein change, and the dBSNP or the RSID. And now let us try to annotate this particular variant. So to annotate this particular variant in the gene TGFBR2, we will look at the VEP results for this particular variant. So from the results, it's evident that there are 2 NMIDs, which means there are 2 variants, and the 2 variants have different changes this time. So we will have to annotate using all the protein changes and the cDNA changes. So let us try annotating with the first cDNA change. So I will search Google Scholar. It retrieved 2 articles. The second article is present in some other language, so I will choose to ignore that particular article. I will open the first article and search for the variant. It's only present once. I will only search using the position now, so that if the variant is present in any other format, it will be visible. So the protein change is 340. So this variant is present in only one particular position in this particular article, and there is no detail about this particular variant, so I will choose to ignore this article. There are no results retrieved via PubMed, and there are no results retrieved via PMC. So I will move forward and use the protein change for searching. So no articles were retrieved using the protein change in Google Scholar as well as in PubMed. In PMC, there was one article retrieved. So let us look at this article. So only in one position, this particular change is reported. There is no other detail. So I will choose to ignore this particular article. So let us now use the second NMID change. So for searching through the second CDNA change, Google Scholar retrieved around 5 articles, PubMed retrieved around 2 results, but these articles are found by citation matching, and hence I will choose to not read these articles because they are not relevant to us because it is already present in the citation. And no results were found using PMC. So let us look at each of these articles one by one. I will not open the fourth and the fifth result because they are Google patents, and we will not refer to Google patents because the complete details will not be available. And this is a citation, so I will not open this article as well. So this article is not available in full text, but then Unpaywall shows a free access to this article. Same for the second article as well. So let us look at these articles. So they say that this variation for which no clear argument for their pathogenicity has been reported are considered as polymorphism until more data are collected. So I don't think I will get any details about that particular variant in this article. So there are two individuals having this particular variant, but no other details is given about that particular variant. So I will choose to ignore these two articles. So let us now search through the protein change. So this has retrieved around 22 results, and this has retrieved one result, and PMC has retrieved around 6 results. So this particular article is present in PMC in full text format, so I will just open it in PMC. Let me open the first article. And the second article is already open in PMC. So I will close this. And let me open the third article. This article we already opened in the first search. So the full text is not available, and it is not available through Unpaywall as well. So full text is available. Full text is available here itself. So this particular paper is talking about this particular variant in association with Marfan syndrome. So let us read through it. Not much detail is given in this particular article, except for the fact that it was present. So let us look at the other two articles. So the first article talks about this particular variant in T315M, which is the protein change we are interested in. So the proband and her two brothers had colorectal cancer, as shown in the figure. So the normal DNA of the proband was heterozygous, and the tumor had loss of wild type fragments. The two brothers had CRC or colorectal cancer at 65 and 60. But they could not obtain the tumor tissue samples from these variant from these patients. The variant was present in the children, but we do not know whether this particular variant but we cannot know whether they would develop or they had CRC because they are too young for it. They screened around 60 individuals, but they did not find the mutation. They did some functional studies. Here from this particular blot as well, we can give PP1 to this particular variant. If the details about the children as well would have been present, then we could have given PP1S, but the details about children is not clear because the children are too young to develop CRC. So there is some effect of T315M, and there is a functional study along with it. And it, so we can say that this particular variant is associated with this particular disease, that is colorectal cancer, on the basis of this publication, and I can assign the attribute of PS3 to this particular variant on the basis of that publication for colorectal cancer. Now let us look at the next publication. So here no details are given, it's only present once. So I will choose to ignore this particular article. Now let us look at the third article. So they say that this particular mutation is a polymorphism in association with Marfan syndrome. A polymorphism was detected in this particular patient. So they are clearly saying that it is associated with colorectal cancer, but it is observed in 1 in 100 controls with respect to Marfan syndrome. Hence, as you can see, that there are two different diseases with which the variant is associated, with which the gene is associated. But then, in one of the diseases, there is no particularly interesting literature available, and it is also noted as a polymorphism in one of the articles. Whereas in the case of colorectal cancer, you could assign the attribute of PS3 and PP1 to this particular variant if you read all the publications. So ACMG conclusions are disease dependent, and only if the disease is available, then you can conclude more accurately. Without the disease information, probably you would get lost, and you cannot assign both the attributes to both the diseases. So it is particularly related to the disease. So one should keep in mind that if you are annotating any particular variant. So let us look at another example from of a variant from the IL-1 RN gene, which I have annotated using VEP and retried the cDNA position, protein change, and the dBSNP ID. Now let us try to annotate this particular variant. So first we will look at how many transcripts are available. So there are around 5 transcripts for that particular variant. Now we will have to search through each of them one by one. So let us search with the first cDNA change. So the first cDNA change did not retrieve any articles in Google Scholar, PubMed, or PMC. Now let us look at the next, now let us search for the protein change associated with that NMID. So it retrieved around 6 results. I will open all the articles which are not book chapters and not present in PMC. So in the first article, the particular protein change that we are interested in is not present, so we will choose to ignore this particular article. And the next article is not available in full text, neither to unpaywall, so we'll keep this article on hold. The next article is also not present in full text, and neither is it present in unpaywall, so we'll keep it on hold. So the other three articles are from PMC. So this variant is only reported in this particular article, so we can ignore this particular article. So even in this article, it's only reported, so we can choose to ignore this particular article. So in this article as well, it's only reported, so we can choose to ignore this article. So in the end, there is only one article that is left, so I will retrieve the PDF of that particular. So in this article as well, this particular variant is only reported and no other details is given. So I will choose to ignore this particular article as well. So now let us search for the second cDNA change. So no articles on Google Scholar, no article on PubMed, and no article on PMC. Let us search for the protein change. So there are around 11 results. But I will not open this result because this is not the change that we are interested in. This is not the change that we are interested in. So I don't think there are any relevant articles. So we need not open these results. There is nothing found on PubMed and there is nothing found on PMC. So let us move to the next NMID change. So there was no result on the second page as well. So So this cDNA change is not found on Google Scholar, neither on PubMed, neither in PMC. So now let us look for the protein change. So no result in PubMed as well, and there is one result in PMC. So this particular article does not have any relevant results. I think it's only the word. It's only the number 127 that is getting repeated again and again, and there is no detail about the variant that we are in. So let us now look at the next NMID. So no results in Google Scholar, no results in PubMed, and no results in PMC. Let us search for the protein change. No result on Google Scholar. No results on PubMed. And no results on PMC. Let us search through the last cDNA change. No results were retrieved. So let us now look at the last protein change. So there are around 11 results retrieved, but then these results are not of particular interest to us. Hence, I will not open these articles as they are not discussing the variant that we are interested in, but it is just a number that is present in the article. So as you can see, there are no results retrieved from, even though we searched with all the protein changes and the cDNA changes from multiple transcripts. Now the last thing that is left to be searched is the RSID. So let us search through the RSID. So this is the RSID retrieved from BEP. So using the RSID, we will search on Google Scholar, PubMed, PMC, ClinVar, and Omen. So this has around 5 results. No results on PubMed, and no result on PMC, and so if you go through each of these publications, then you'll know it is just reported, this variant is just reported and not particularly, no detail about the variant is given. Here as well, the variant is reported. So it is not found in PubMed or PMC. And ClinVar says that this variant is benign. On the basis of publications found, we've read through each of these articles, but we could not find any details to annotate the variant as pathogenic or benign. So even after searching through all the NMID changes and all the protein changes and the RSID at Google Scholar, PubMed and PMC, along with ClinVar and OMIM, we did not retrieve any details to classify this particular variant as a pathogenic or benign. So in such cases, when no evidence is found for that particular variant, then we could just annotate the variant on the basis of other attributes, which we will learn about in the future lectures, and then annotate the variant on the basis of those attributes. So do not panic if no literature is found or no literature on the basis of which you could assign ACMG attributes is found. We can still annotate the variants on the basis of other attributes, which we will discuss in the future lectures. So now let us try to understand which papers to read and which papers to ignore. So as we browse through different variants and the articles that we could mine using the search terms, we found many patents and book chapters and thesis extract which we completely ignored. And sometimes there are articles where there is a random match or there is a match in the DOI or the reference section. Such articles also we should ignore. And articles which are not discussing the gene or the variant of interest, as we found in one of the examples, we should ignore such articles. And articles on the basis of no attributes can be assigned can also be ignored. Obviously, we cannot know this unless we read this article or at least scan through the article. But the other things we can ignore straight away only on the basis of the search result. And what to read particularly, we could read any research article, any review article on the variant. So review article, we'll have to go back to the research article and then find out what exactly did they do about that variant and how did they arrive at a conclusion. So review article needs a little bit of back referencing. Any article discussing the gene or the variant of interest should be read. And at least it should be scanned through, and then we should try to understand whether we should read the article in detail or we can just ignore the article. So these are the papers which should be read or ignored. So I hope that now it is clear. And so how do we know when to stop mining the literature? So when we have searched using all search terms and the combinations, and also we have searched through each of the literature databases that we have been discussing in the previous few lectures, such as Google Scholar, PubMed, PMC, ClinVar, and OMIM. And if we have found relevant articles or if we have not found any relevant articles, but if we have completed all the search term combinations and we have used all the transcripts and we have not ignored any transcripts and we have read through each of these articles, if there are any, then we can finally stop mining the literature. And we need not worry about if we have reached a conclusion or not. If we have searched all the search terms and the databases, then we can finally stop. So I hope by the end of this lecture, you could now understand how to search through the literature for different attributes. And I hope that some attributes which were confusing to you are now clear. And also now you know when to stop and how to mine the literature more efficiently and which literature to scan through and which literature to actually read in detail. So I hope that now you are more clear about the attributes that can be derived through literature. I hope that now you can do better annotations as compared to the previous week. Thank you.